Piper, thank you so much for sitting down with us today at Studio Movie Girl. We're so excited to have you here.
Oh, thanks for having me.
So the first thing we would love to know is, what was it like getting started with Netflix and turning this amazing book into a TV series?
Well, I met Jenji Kohan in 2010, which was when the book came out. And, you know, you're always thrilled when the book finds readers, any readers. But Jenji Kohan was an exciting reader for sure. Someone said, you know, Jenji Kohan really likes your book. And I was like, whoa. So that's really how I got started. You know, Jenji and I had a long lunch and she asked millions and millions of questions. And at the end of that lunch, she said, I'd really like to do this as my next project. And I was like, wow. So Netflix came into the picture later. They are fantastic. You know, obviously Jenji and her production team are amazing as they sort of create the world of Litchfield Prison.
Yeah.
And Netflix is a fantastic distribution, you know, partner. And obviously they are bringing out so much fascinating, amazing new content.
Mm-hmm. So how was it, that process, taking the book? What creative liberties did they take? You know, what was it like turning that book into a TV series?
Well, Jenji has total liberty. I mean, she has okay. the right and the ability to do whatever she wants with the mm-hmm. springboard of the book in the series. And of course, she's done incredibly cool, amazing things.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they say they take the book and they put it in a blender and they put a lot of other ingredients in there and they press liquefy.
Mm-hmm.
And the results are fascinating for me, obviously, as an author and as a memoirist specifically. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting to see how they take bits and pieces and storylines and settings from the book and they change them and they adapt them and they twist them and they turn them. And it's really interesting.
So did you play a role in that adaptation? You know, all of the characters, they have different names and some of the situations are different. Mm-hmm. Did you get to kind of play around with that script a little?
So Jenji has about 8 writers who work with her in Los Angeles. The show is shot in New York, which is where okay. I am usually living. And, you know, I'm a consultant on the show, and that what that mainly means is that I answer questions. So Jenji has questions, the writers have questions, the set designer has questions.
Mm-hmm.
I answer them to the best of my ability. And I read scripts, and I give feedback, and I really try to keep that feedback very specifically grounded in helping make Litchfield a mm-hmm. realistic world. Something that really right. is grounded in what is it like to live your life day to day in a federal women's minimum security prison.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of living that day to day, seeing these characters on screen and seeing Taylor Schilling play you on screen, how is that remembering what it was like for you and your experience and then seeing these characters on screen?
Well, Taylor does such a beautiful, beautiful job. It's amazing. I remember I had not met Taylor before she was cast, mm-hmm. and I met her when we were actually shooting the very first episode. And so, you know, my husband, Larry, and I went to visit the set, and we were really nervous, and it was very overwhelming. And I got to meet Taylor, and I think we were both nervous. And then I began to watch them shooting a scene. With 5 characters, Natasha Lyonne is in there, Kate Mulgrew is in there, and it's a complicated scene with so many characters, and it is one that is fairly closely grounded in the book. It's really pretty close mm-hmm. to what really happened in that scene. And I remember feeling a sense of relief and relaxation as I watched them filming it, even though it was completely intriguing and, you know, I was sort of on the edge of my seat as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because I just felt like, this is going to be good. She's great. They're great. You know, I felt this huge wash of relief and, like, my sense of anxiety really diminished. But I'll tell you, I watched the character of Piper Chapman. And that character is really, to me, a creation of Jenji Kohan's writing and Taylor Schilling's acting.
Okay.
I don't watch that character and feel like, oh, that's me, or, you know, some very weird version mm-hmm. of me. I think of that character as something quite different.
So did you sit down with her whenever she was going through character development and kind of work with her on you and, you know, your experience?
No, I don't think Taylor is trying to imitate me at all.
Okay.
I think she's really working from the page. She's working from the script. And the script obviously has the jumping off point of the book.
Mm-hmm.
But anyone who watches the show and has also read the book knows that even in that very first episode, even though there's a lot in the first episode that is directly from the book, there are also some huge departures from the true story.
Right. So how does your husband feel about Jason Biggs?
He loves Jason Biggs. We just went to see Jason in the Heidi Chronicles on Broadway. Oh. Amazing performance. You know, him and Elizabeth Moss and a great cast. Larry thinks Jason is great, and Larry has a great sense of humor about that character and about the show in general, and that's cool.
Yeah. Well, that has to be so much fun, just watching the progression of the show and just being on this journey with the show and with your book, you know, especially experiencing that with Larry. It has to be a really cool experience.
I'm very fortunate. I'm very, very lucky. I'm very lucky that Genji and such a creative group of people came to the work and wanted to work on the project together.
Yeah. So in your book, you talk about needing to take risks frequently and often, and that being something that drives you. Which was a bigger risk for you, writing your book and publishing a book about your experience, or diving into creating the series with Netflix?
Well, there's a lot of risk involved in sharing your personal story, whatever that story might be. Because of course we're all vulnerable in that moment when we're exposing a lot of truths about ourselves and about our perspective on the world. Obviously the book is my story. Word for word, I'm responsible for every single word that's in that book. And then when you turn over a book for adaptation, you are really relinquishing control. You know, I'm turning over control to Genji, and she is creating that world of Litchfield as opposed to the real world of Danbury. But the truth is, from my perspective, the instant that you publish a book, you have given that story away to the world. You have given that story to the reader. Like, every single reader who reads the book brings their own perspective and their own life experience to the story. And they interpret it differently, and that's an amazing thing, actually. And that, you know, the adaptation to the series is just an extension of that idea. So I'm happy for the world to have this story, because I'm very happy for the world to think more about all those people that we lock away in prison and jail in this country.
So now, with publishing your book and it being a number one New York bestseller, and with Orange is the New Black on Netflix, how has that created opportunities and outlets for you to discuss one of your passions, prison reform and reentry and integration for prisoners?
Well, when I wrote the book, what I hoped is that the reader would come away and have a different idea, perhaps, about who's in prison. So, for example, women, and why they're there. You know, the reasons that we lock people up are not always what people assume. And what really happens to people behind the walls of a prison or a jail, because those communities that exist behind the walls of every prison and jail are very hidden from the eyes of the public, which is one of the reasons we're so curious about them, is because they're hidden away. And I imagined, or I hoped, that if I told the story in a really pop culture way, that more people might pick up the book and read it than would typically read a book about prison. Obviously, with the show, you know, you reach many millions more people than even the best-selling book ever does. What I really hope is simply that we think about people in prison as people, and that we recognize that every person who's locked away is more than just their worst day. They also have best days, and they have people who care about them and love them, and they're capable of more than just their worst day. So I think the show really shows that beautifully. I hope that the book shows that as well, but I think that the way that Genji has chosen to create the show, with those incredibly compelling backstories, which are entirely fictional, the backstories do not come from my book, she does a beautiful job of really showing each and every one of those female protagonists as complete human beings with complicated lives, and I think that that's really important.
Yeah, well, in your book, there are so many instances where, you know, as a reader, I was reading through the book thinking, could this really happen? You know, because you're right when you said that we're curious because we don't know. Mm-hmm. It's so unknown. What has been the response to some of those things in the book as well as the TV series? Have people kind of come to you and said, wow, I didn't realize these things happened?
Absolutely. I think that for, you know, we lock away more people in this country than any other country in the world. And when we send people away to prison and jail, it's very much out of sight, out of mind. And mm-hmm. so I think that people read the book or they watch the show and they're like, wow, I never thought about that. I never thought about sort of the survival struggle that is entailed mm-hmm. in trying to get through the experience of incarceration. It's always funny to me when people watch the show and say, oh, that couldn't possibly have happened. And I'm like, oh no, that's from the book.
Yeah.
So like in the first season when Crazy Eyes pees on the floor, I was like, oh no, that happened.
Yeah, some of those instances, it really is hard to believe. It's like, wow, mm-hmm. you know, I didn't know. I know personally, I didn't realize that people went through things like that, mm-hmm. especially yeah. in there. Was there a specific moment that while you were spending your time in Danbury that you realized, I want to write a book about this experience. I want to share this with people and I want to bring awareness.
When I was incarcerated, I was really focused on survival, and that's true for most people. Most mm-hmm. and most people in prison are less fortunate than I am, so that survival struggle is really top of mind, day in and day out. Mm-hmm. How am I going to get through the day? When things were really crazy in the unit that I was assigned to live in, every now and then my bunkie, you know, the woman who I shared a bunk bed with, would turn to me and say, go home and write a book, bunkie. Go home and write a book. And I would laugh. But ultimately, after I went home, I did choose to do that. And I was very, very lucky that I got a great editor who helped me write an even better book than I was capable of writing on my own, and that the book found readers. And for that, I am very grateful.
Yeah, well, found plenty of readers, it being a number one bestseller. So you are actually working on a second book now. Yes. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, I am working in Ohio, and I'm teaching writing classes in a men's prison and a women's prison. Both of them are state prisons. And those classes are fantastic and amazing, and the students in my classes are writing nonfiction. They're writing their own stories or, you know, aspects of their life, sometimes things they witnessed rather than things that are completely memoirish. Mm-hmm. But I am fascinated by the things they choose to write about, and they tell great stories. Of course, everybody who's locked up in prison or jail has some great stories, like, you can trust that. And I'm really grateful that those wardens are allowing me to be there and to do that work.
Very, very cool. So are these stories, is it going to be a compilation of these stories that the prisoners write?
The plan is that the best writing from both classes will get published as an anthology, and we're very excited about that.
Yeah, I bet that's really exciting for them as well, having that opportunity.
I think so. I think so. I think they, it's a year-long class, so they'll mm-hmm. have a lot of opportunity to really work on the stories that they think are most important and to tell the stories that are most compelling.
Wow. Well, we know that the next season of Orange is the New Black comes out this June 12th.
June 12th.
Can you tell us anything about that? Give us any spoilers, teasers?
I can tell you that there are several completely new storylines which are very exciting. Some of them are really funny. Some of them are really shocking. I think that there's one storyline which is grounded in the reality of the American prison system, which I think many people have no idea that this goes on in the American prison system, so I think that will be really interesting for viewers. I think if I reveal anything too specific, though, they might lock me up again, like in a broom closet or something. I would be in big trouble.
Well, we wouldn't want that to happen. Don't want to go back to that. Last question. One of the things we do here at Studio Movie Girl is we have a full bar and a full American Girl menu. Mm. So one thing we like to ask our guests is if you could describe your book mm-hmm. and your TV show, Orange is the New Black, as a drink, what would that drink be?
Well, probably a tequila sunrise with that vivid orange and, mm-hmm. you know, a really strong belt of tequila.
Well, we'll be sure to remember that. And if we screen Orange is the New Black, we'll be sure to serve tequila sunrises.
All right. Fantastic.
Yep. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it.
Oh, nice talking with you today.
I just want to say,
I can be a famous rapper, you know what I'm saying? Like, January, yeah. February, oh, March, April, May, and June.
Welcome to Litchfield, 2.0.
This place is amazing. The walls are so clean. And I haven't heard anybody screaming.
That's amazing! a whole new world around here.
It's a beautiful day. I turned over a new leaf.
Sounds kind of crazy.
Why, you just said that, my nipples got like super hard.
You know, the hot one's back.
Betty Page of Litchfield.
How am I back here?
Aw, it's so nice to see you guys back together.
Maybe this is exactly where I am supposed to be right now.
Stop trying to mold the real world into the one inside your pointy blonde head. The world is better in black and white. And red. I'm so sorry!
You need to get out of here before you add another 100 years to my sentence.
This is just great!
Don't you try nothing.
I love everybody.
This piece of writing is obscene. It's pornographic.
No, it's not just sex. It's love. It's two people connecting with four other people and aliens.